All right, so we talked a little bit about the importance or why we even look at the frequency distribution. And one of the things we're interested in with our data is the distribution of data. Where's the data located? And so we'll talk a lot about data that is normally distributed. Data that's normally distributed looks like this. Okay, so that means the values that are that occur most frequently are in the middle. And then as we go out, the values decrease to the left and right at about the same rate. Okay, so that's data that's normally distributed. We've got our most popular values in the center, and then as we go out, the frequencies decrease at about the same rate left and right. So how do we look at something like this and decide if it's normally distributed? Well, our middle class would be what? 80 to 89 is the class that's in the middle. Okay, this is the one that's in the middle, and it happens to have what? The highest frequency. Okay, this is our middle class. It has the highest frequency. And then what happens is we go one class below and one class above. Decreases at the same rate, roughly. Okay, and then here, same thing, right? We got 10 and 8. And then when we go one more, we got 4 here and 5 in these other two classes. Not perfect. Life's not perfect, okay? But roughly speaking, we would say, yes, this data is approximately normally distributed, okay? Okay, we like things to be normally distributed. Okay, questions about that? About what a normal distribution is and how we look at a frequency that is normally distributed. Okay, very good. All right, given that the first two frequencies of a frequency distribution are 2 and 6, respectively, and that the distribution of the 40 values is normally distributed, find the remaining 4 frequencies. Okay, so what would you do in this case? Okay, put 2 and 6 at the bottom. Okay, we've got to have basically the same distribution on both sides of the center. So we got 2 and 6 over here at the extreme. So I'm doing 2 and 6 there. Then what does that leave us with? Leaves us with 24. And so we got two classes where we need to distribute that 24. So we'd say 12 and 12. That would be in a perfect case. But that'd be the best way to do that. Questions about that? Okay. About this entire thing? Okay, since they said we were normally distributed, that means the values have to be at the same frequencies as we go out. So they gave us that there were 2 values in this first class and 6 in the next. All right, and then here we got 2 and 6. Okay, does that make sense, that part? Because it's normally distributed. So we want them to match. The thing about the normal distribution is, and this is just kind of an outline of a chart of the data, but if we were to fold it over on this line, they match, okay? And so that's what we're doing here. All right, so we did 2 and 6, and then they said it was 40 values, so we had 24 values left over. We split them evenly, okay? I put one in one side, one on the other. Right. Doesn't matter. Because it doesn't have to be perfect. Okay. Life's not perfect. We'll find out when we get to chapter 4, which is one of my favorites. That, you know, you can flip a coin 1,000 times. You're not going to get 500 heads and 500 tails. You know, not every time. Maybe sometimes, but not all the time. So, you know, we've got this This is in theory, but in practice it's not. So if you throw one to one side, one to the other, it's not going to make that big of a difference. Okay? All right. Weights of respondents were recorded as part of the California Health Interview Survey. The last digits of weights from 50 randomly selected respondents are listed below. Construct a frequency distribution with 10 classes. Based on the distribution, do the heights appear to be reported or actually measured? Okay, very good. All right, so when we look at this, just quickly, we see we've got digits ranging from 0 to 9. So I'll let those be my classes. We can do what we call an ungrouped frequency distribution, where instead of having a range of values for the classes, you've got individual values. Okay? If the data set is small enough, and if we have discrete data like we do here, we can do that. All right, I need some people to count zeros, some to count ones, twos, threes, etc. Okay? Just pick a number and count. Okay, 2 4s, 1 9. What? Okay, there were 12 fives, is that what I heard? Yes, okay, what else?
4 8s.
4 8s. 2 3s. Okay, 1 2.
1 6.
Okay, 1 6. 1 1. Okay, and? Okay, and what about sevens? No sevens. Okay, very good. All right, so here we have this. We could make it a little better, give it a title, say what these things are. These are what, heights? Oh, weights, okay. All right, weights, and then these would be the frequencies. I don't know if I said this in class, but a good chart, which this is not, should be able to stand on its own. 1,000 years from now, if somebody picks it up, they should know what these numbers or this chart represent. So when we get on over to dealing with charts and things, you want to make sure it has an appropriate title, appropriate labels on the axes, you know, that kind of thing, so people know what it's supposed to represent. But looking at this, what do you think it tells us? If these are supposed to be weights, and we're looking at these are not weights, I'm sorry, these are the last digits of reported weights. So what does that say? What did people do? They didn't tell the truth. Okay. They what? Somebody else? They rounded, right? People just kind of rounded. And you can see it in the data. If people really tell the truth, the last digit in, you know, weights, there's no particular pattern to that. So we would expect that data would be more uniform. All right? All of the values would occur at about the same rate. All right? You know, there's nothing about your weight that causes you to gravitate towards, you know, a weight ending in 2. You know, everything occurs at about the same rate. So looking at the data, because that's what we're trying to do. You know, we're not just doing this to have fun. I mean, it's enjoyable, but, you know, we want to learn something from it. And so by looking at the ending digits, we can see that people rounded, you know, embellished, you know, just didn't want to tell the whole truth or whatever. Okay? Questions about that? Okay, use the given categorical data to construct the relative frequency distribution. Okay, again, this is what it just said, a categorical frequency distribution. So we've got data that is qualitative, and we're still going to prepare a frequency distribution from it. You all are going to do a frequency distribution of qualitative data with the M&Ms once I release that data set to you. So we can do frequency distributions for qualitative data. And in fact, they want us to do what kind of frequency distribution? Relative, okay? So I would do the causes, and they are bad track. Equipment. Human error. Other. Is that it? Okay. All right, so we would have our frequencies. Okay, we run through here. Everybody count something. What'd you do? Okay, 23 T's for bad track. Okay. Okay, 9 E's for equipment. Okay, 12 H's and 6 O's. Okay. All right, and they said 50. So we could kind of do a little check by adding up 12 and 8 is 20, 30, 40, 50. Okay, we got 50 altogether. Okay. And the relative frequency then is going to be 23 over 50. Okay, and then 9 over 50. Whatever those numbers come out to be. 12 over 50 and 6 over 50. And actually, that's going to be what? Wouldn't this be 46.46? 0.18? 0.24? And 0.12? All right, so these are my relative frequencies, all right? And I would give this an appropriate title, Causes of 50 Train Derailment Incidents. Questions about that? Okay, excellent.